morning. I would like to start by thanking Geotecnia Brasil for the kind invitation to present this lecture on the interaction between foundations and excavations, typically tunnels. And I will talk on the possibility of analytical solutions. It's my pleasure to deliver this lecture, and I will be present at the end of this presentation to answer any questions that may arise at the end. During the past few years, I was able to collaborate and to work in a few projects in Barcelona regarding railways. And this is the first I would like to mention very briefly. This yellow line here is the position of a tunnel that goes along this street, which is in the center of Barcelona. And you see it is very close to this monument here. In fact, this is a church, a very well-known church. It's the Sagrada Familia Temple. It is a World Heritage building by UNESCO. And certainly the proximity of the tunnel to this building raised some concern in the city. This is a view of the Sagrada Familia from another perspective. This is the interior. You see, this is the style, is a modernist style of this church. The second case I would like to mention also very briefly is the crossing of the Barcelona International Airport. We have two terminals, and very recently a railway line. Again, this is marked here by this yellow line here. Went through the second terminal, terminal number two. It went into the airfield and then it ended into terminal one. You can have a look at this area here. This is a flat area. In fact, this is a delta. The Mediterranean Sea is in the background. Therefore, the tight soils are typically soft soils, normally consolidated soils. Now, see, this is the position of the tunnel crossing the terminal two, and you see that it is quite close to the structure of the terminal. At the upper part of the tunnel, we have fine sands, and then below, clays and clay seals. It's not only a question of the proximity, but also this tunnel has to look for a way through a pile foundations of different lengths, as illustrated here, in a soft soil, essentially. So again, this was an important project with difficulties to solve it. Both projects, in both cases, the tunnels were built with a machine like this one. It's an earth pressure balance seal, EPBS. And you may have a look at the different parts of this machine, but typically this is a seal, which means that the excavation is protected by a very big tube, in this case, something like 10 meters in diameter. Inside this tube, which is not very long, you have all the machinery. They are the machinery that actually is rotating the front wheel, which is making actually the excavation, but also very importantly, the tunnel itself, which is made of dowels, as indicated here, is built under the protection of this shield. And the shield itself advances when these jacks actually push forward, and they push forward against the tunnel already built. The problem is that this shield has some thickness, it's a strong steel shield. The thickness may be something like a few centimeters, 4, 5, 6, 7 centimeters. And therefore, there is a gap when your tunnel comes out of the protection of the shield. In fact, the tunnel goes down a little bit, and therefore, the gap tends to be higher, bigger in the upper part, and smaller in the lower part. Now, in the traditional way of looking at the problem of the movements induced by these gaps, I can refer to the work or to the first, I will say, relatively comprehensive analysis. I think it was made by Peck in a report, I think in the 1969 International Conference on Soil Mechanics. And in this report, he showed a number of examples showing that the settlements that you actually measure on the surface follow an equation which is very similar to a Gaussian equation. In fact, this equation is written here on the right. And the reason for these settlements is precisely this gap that I was referring before. In fact, this is, I think, a representation of this gap. The first circle corresponds to the outer surface of the shield, and the one which is below it corresponds to the outer circle, in this case, of the tunnel itself. And as I said before, because of the thickness of the gap and also because of the small falling down of the tunnel when it abandons the protection of the shield, you have this approximate shape of the gap. So this is a volume loss, and this is the representation for this volume loss, this VS. Now this VS can be approximated by the integral of this surface settlement. You may say, well, this is not very accurate, and this is true, because if you have some kind of volume change or the latency in the soil, this integral will not be equal to this volume loss at the level of the tunnel, but it is very similar in many cases. Now, if you divide this equation here by the area of the tunnel, then you have a dimensionless volume loss, which is expressed typically in percentage. Now, if you look at this equation of this settlement trough, it has two parameters. One is the maximum displacement at the center, and the other one is this I parameter here, which is the abscissa of the change in curvature of this curve. Again, this is an approximation. It's an empirical approximation. This I is roughly equal to half the depth of the center of the tunnel. Now, if you put together these equations here, you have this expression for the vertical displacements at any abscissa here with this axis here. Interestingly, in this equation, you don't see any reference to any soil property, except that this VS star, which is, as I said, the volume loss, and these are typical numbers that you may find in current work in tunneling using the earth pressure balance sheet, maybe 0.1%, 0.5%, so it's a small quantity. But this amount depends on a number of things, and in particular also on the soil type. So the softer the soil, the more difficult it is to go to small values here. But there is no any direct reference to any soil property, and in particular the stiffness of the soil. And this tells you that these problems of deformations associated with volume losses in our soil are kinematically controlled. And this is an advantage, because this can help us to simplify the analysis. Now, it turns out that the motion of the, for instance, a point such as this one at the surface is not a vertical displacement. In fact, it is a vector, and this vector, which is the red vector here, points toward approximately the center of this tunnel, a little bit higher, but I think the center is good enough. Now, if we accept this, if you know the expression for the vertical displacement, you immediately can calculate in this triangle here, the horizontal displacement. So verticals and horizontal displacements are of concern when you are thinking in some damage to structures, as indicated here. So this is the vertical displacements. And now, if you follow my explanation before, the geometry of the horizontal displacements is exactly what you have here, with a zero here because of the symmetry, and then the displacements go in opposite directions when you move from the right side to the left side. Now, if you divide these displacements by a reference length means a length that makes sense in your building, then you have something that you may call differential settlements, but those are strengths, those are dimensionless quantities. Okay, I call them the flexion ratio here, or in the case of the vertical displacements, and horizontal strain in the case of the horizontal displacements. And beginning probably in this well-known paper, there has been an interest in relating, correlating those two strains, which are represented here in these two axes, with the expected damage to a building. And at the beginning, all these plots were referring to relatively simple buildings, Certainly not the Sagrada Familia church that I mentioned at the beginning. All right, so this is just a very short and simple introduction that takes me to the contents of my presentation. I will describe the interaction between the tunnel and not a simple foundation, but a pile group foundation. In fact, both the Sagrada Familia Church and certainly the terminals of the airport were founded on piles, pile groups. And then I will refer to a way of protecting structures from tunneling using protection walls, and I will come back to these Sagrada Familia temples. And then I will be close to the end and I will just comment on some lessons. Now, let me start by this tunnel pile group interaction. So I divided the problem into the structure itself, the pile group, which is loaded, and then you may also think, if you are interested in solving in terms of, for instance, displacements of stresses, this structure, you need to know the loads applied to typically every point of this structure. For instance, if you think in the piles, you have this particular segment here associated to a given point here, in which we will have normal stresses and tangential stresses, etc. On the other hand, if you think in the soil that is around this structure, you may have also displacement. Well, yeah, and the reason is clear. You will have just the opposite loads, as I mentioned before, so you just have to change the sign if you look at this particular point in the soil for the shear stress and for the normal stress. And you may have, of course, a more generalized situation here, right? But what I am especially concerned is the possibility of having in the proximity of this structure of something which is my tunnel, which because of the volume loss that I mentioned before, there will be displacements around this tunnel. Those displacements will be some external action toward my structure. Therefore, the displacements of the soil will be a combination. Combination means a sum of the displacements induced by these reverse or opposite loads induced by the structure, my pile group on the soil, plus any displacements produced by the construction of the tunnel. So I may distinguish what I call a soil structure just to show you or to understand that I will deal with mechanics and with deformations, etc. Now my soil will be an homogeneous and isotropic elastic half space. An additional simplification is incompressibility, and there is a reason for that. It's simply a matter of convenience. But remember that kinematic conditions dominate, as I also mentioned at the beginning. In order to be able to describe the displacements in the soil when you load it, then I will use three fundamental solutions. Certainly you will know the best first one, Businesque, Milding, the second one, and the third one is Sagaceta. I will immediately have a very short description of these fundamental solutions. What about my structure properly? Well, the piles. Well, the piles is a simple structure. For instance, if you consider a single pile, the lateral response can be in the sense of determining the displacements, can be obtained by simply solving this fourth order differential equation. And this Py, for instance, is the normal stress at a given point. So you can do that either analytically or you can use a simple numerical method. The vertical response is even simpler, and I just indicated here this very simple equation telling you the equilibrium in vertical direction. Now, the fundamental solutions that I mentioned before are Businesque, concentrated loads at the surface of a half space, vertical and horizontal forces. Milding is a continuation of this set of analytical solutions, but now my point loads are inside the half space. Both are algebraic expressions. The third fundamental solution is due to my colleague, Professor Sagaceta, his professor in the north of Spain, in Santander. And he derived this nice paper, the expressions for the displacements in a half space due to a volume loss. You can imagine here a sphere that collapses, or whatever, right? And those expressions are a little bit more complicated because they involve the integration of elliptic functions. All right, so what is the calculation procedure? Well, I cannot enter here in much detail, but you have to establish the compatibility of vertical and horizontal displacements of the soil and the pile. And, but this is just a simple equation. Simply you make equal the displacements at the same point calculated on the structure or calculated in the soil. And this provides you a set of equations that can be solved if you have equilibrium conditions. There are books that tell you and explain you in detail how to do that. But in our case now, we have to introduce the tunnel. Now, the critical point in the tunnel is to understand how a soil deforms when you have a given point inside your half space, a volume loss, for instance, and sphere as indicated here. You have to accept two things. One is that this displacement is a vector in any point which is directed towards the center of this sphere. And the second important point is that the magnitude of this displacement depends on the distance between every particular point and this center of the volume loss. And the displacement decreases fast when your distance to a given point increases. But this way of looking at the displacements induced by volume loss, I think, is quite powerful. Now, let's now concentrate on the tunnel. The tunnel is more complicated than just an spherical volume loss. Because if you remember, I was referring to this particular shape, particular geometry of the volume loss. So now in three dimensions, you have the tunnel being built by the shield, which is here, this is what you have. And now this volume loss is the one that actually is producing those displacements around the tunnel. Now, in order to introduce my fundamental solution, one thing I can do is to describe this complicated geometry by a set of fundamental or small, if you like, volume losses, for instance, by dividing this difference of volume between this internal circle and the outer circle in the manner indicated here. So the upper part, close to the crown of your tunnel, you will have a bigger volume loss if compared, I mean, for the same angle here, with a volume loss which actually is taking place in the lower part of the tunnel. But you can do that. You can describe then a relatively complicated volume loss by using a set of isolated volume losses. Now we put everything, these ideas together and built, and this was the work of a student, a master student, a very nice work. He actually developed in MATLAB a program that actually solves this particular problem. You have a tunnel, you have your pile foundation of any type, and then you would like to know the interaction between this tunnel and this pile foundation. Interaction means, in particular, that I would like to know what are the displacements, the efforts, the forces, etc., at every point or at every pile, etc., of this pile group. This is an example to show you what happens when you excavate a tunnel with this geometry, this depth of the center point, diameter, position with respect to the to this 3x3 group of piles. And I will introduce as an approximation to the real construction of a tunnel, that my tunnel started 100 meters before the center of this pile group, and it moved towards the tunnel. So when the coordinate X is zero, you are right at the center, and then you continue the excavation, and then you go far away 100 meters more. So this is a construction of 200 meters. Now, I need just a few properties, and this is nice because these properties are easy to approximate, and also you can also change them in order to have some idea of what is the effect of each one of these properties controlling this problem. Now for the pines, you have the length, 25 meters, 1 meter diameter. This is just an academic example. This is the stiffness, the modulus E of the concrete, and then the Poisson ratio. For the soil, this is a classical elastic half space. So a value for E, for the modulus, and then for nu, remember this is no volume change. And then for the tunnel, I will select a volume loss. Now this volume loss is 1%. We remember what it is. I approximate it by a set of individual volume losses in the manner with the geometry I explained before. This is the diameter of the tunnel, and this is the position, etc. So this is the problem. Now here is in plan view the position of the tunnel. Look at those two axes, X in the direction of the tunnel itself, and then perpendicular to it, Y. And I will look at, well, any, and we'll get information for any pile, in particular piles 4, 5, and 1, which are in the positions indicated here. Now, this is the problem. So this is the existing pile group. And then there is my tunnel that comes close to it. And then I am excavating it step by step. Well, a step means, in this case, 2 meters. And so time step, you want to call it time, 25 corresponds to 50 meters of excavation. This is the green part. 50 more, and then I am now right at the center of the group. And then I continue the excavation, etc., up to 100 meters more. Right. So this is the problem. Now, I will present to you some results of this computational procedure. Let's look at the horizontal displacements in the direction of the tunnel axis, X. And I represent here those displacements along the depth of the pile on the left, and then on the right, the calculated bending moments. If you remember what I said about what is the displacements induced, for instance, by some excavation here, I told you that any point wants to move in that direction, and this vector, in fact, is going to the center of my volume loss here. Now, if we approach the pile group, those vectors will be inclined more and more, etc., And then when I continue in this direction, if I excavate here, for instance, then my displacement of, for instance, any point in this pipe will go in this direction, just looking at the center of this volume loss. When I am here at the end, my vectors will go in this direction. So you see, those two directions are in opposite sense. And there is a symmetry here. So the displacement will be the same when you approach or when you leave the group. And therefore, if you calculate and your calculations are correct, if you start in time step one, you have zero displacements, you get the maximum when your time step is 50, that means 100 meters, so you are here. But if you continue excavating, the displacement go back to zero. So this is a purely reversible displacement. There will be some maximum moments at the time of, that is now here, at the time of time step 50. And these are the moments here. In fact, those moments are the second derivative, if you remember that, for the curvature of this displacement. You will have immediately, you can derive this shape from this shape by looking at the curvature of this displacement curve. Now, if I look at another pile, before was pile number four, which was closer to the tunnel. Pile number five is a little bit farther away, but this has an importance because now the displacements, for instance, for 100 meters of excavation, when the tunnel is right at the middle of your pile group, is smaller than before. The curvature is also smaller here. And therefore, your moments, you compare them with the previous slide, you will see that are significantly smaller, etc. So I could go from pile to pile, looking at bending moments, everything in fact, shear forces, normal forces. So I am illustrating just a few cases. Now, what about the horizontal displacements? But now in the y direction. In the y direction means in the perpendicular direction to the previous one. So now, you have to look at the displacements in this direction. So if you remember the idea of the vector, now the only thing you have to do is to project your vector in a direction which is the y direction here. And you will always have some component in the y direction because the tunnel is not just a line going through the center of your particular pile. So every pile will have different displacements. Now, if you remember my explanation, and if you look at this component of your vector in the y direction, you will realize immediately that the displacements accumulate all the time. So when you start, they begin accumulating, and you continue to accumulate them all the during the whole excavation from minus 100 to mass plus 100 meters. And therefore, if I represent the y displacements of our piles, for the different time steps, 1, 46, here I am, whatever, 50, and I go to 100 time steps, so 200 meters of tunnel. And this is the maximum, I get the maximum here. And if you compare with the previous slide, you will see that my displacements here have a different shape, and also you will have different numbers here. And if you take the second derivative here, then you will have your moments here. And the maximum distribution of bending moments in this particular example corresponds to the final position in this particular example. This is for pile number four. Now, I can represent also those displacements, for instance, the y displacement, or the moments, the bending moments associated with those displacements, as a function of, well, the position of the tunnel, or even time, if you have a direct relationship between your position of the tunnel and the time. And well, this is what you get. At the beginning, you are far from your tunnel is far from your pile group, so you don't notice much. And then the displacements begin to accumulate. The maximum rate corresponds to the proximity of the tunnel, the tunnel head, to your particular pile. And then eventually, when you continue the work, excavation of your tunnel. This will tend asymptotically to essentially zero. And then these are the moments in this particular pile again, and then you will have typically the same type of behavior. But I can calculate other things, for instance, the vertical displacements. If you remember the position of your pile group and the tunnel is here. So every point here, when there is a volume loss here, if you imagine the displacement vector, the points which are above the tunnel will tend to move down. But there are many points here also in the pile that due to the excavation of the tunnel, and remember that the crown gap was the most significant one, they will move in the upward direction. Therefore, the piles will be subjected to a compression load because of this displacement moving in the vertical direction but in the opposite senses. And because of that, if you, of course, integrate everything, this is what the program does, then you will have these vertical displacements along depth for different time steps. And as you can see here, the time steps, the displacements for the time steps accumulate all the time up to the end. If you calculate the axial force, this is what you get. You get a maximum at some particular depth, which is more or less, a little bit higher than the center of the tunnel because of this effect that I was explaining to you. There are more things that you can get from this approach. For instance, shear stresses in a particular pile. This is a representation of the shear stresses that you may have theoretically when your tunnel is at those particular the head of the tunnel. At these particular positions here, this is for pile number 4. When you look at the pipe which is farther away, those decrease also very fast, etc. So it's a real complete solution. And for three-dimensional geometry, a relatively complicated geometry, even for modern finite element codes, it will take some effort, certainly, to describe a complicated geometry of a pile group plus a tunnel with the complications that I mentioned before of the volume loss, etc. is not an easy task. And however, the fundamental solutions are capable of giving you a very nice idea of how your structure is behaving in the presence of a tunnel. Now, let me now go back to this picture and talk about a little bit about this real case, the design of this tunnel for the high-speed train between Barcelona and France. This is the soil which is excavated by the tunnel. Here you have the scale. This tunnel is just in the center of the street. This is the Mallorca Street. And this is a detailed map of the underground, of the soils. So in the upper part, you have this red material here, which are quaternary silts and clays, quite stiff, I would say. They are cemented, non-saturated. And right below them, you have these tertiary sandy clays. Again, this is a stiff material, but this is a mixture of sand lenses and clay and silt lenses also, which well complicates a little bit, especially the question of the flow of water in this particular case when you excavate the tunnel and another structure, for instance, shafts, as I will mention later on. Now, this is the soil. And this is the design that after some discussion was selected to protect the church. So the church is here, Sagrada Familia. It is founded on piles, relatively short piles. And this is the tunnel. This is the street, relatively narrow street. This is typical of the center of Barcelona. This is a quarter, which was built typically in the 19th century, 18th, 19th century. And so the idea was to reduce to the minimum the displacements of the foundations of the Sagrada Familia Church by locating here a protection wall. Now, this wall is made of piles, 41 meters long, 1.5 meters diameter, so big piles, and they are located at centers which are spaced 2 meters And therefore, there is some passage, and in fact, this is a passage for the water in between the pipes, and the water has to drain towards the Mediterranean Sea to the coast in Barcelona. On the top of this pipe, you have a cap beam, and also you have a reaction beam, which was introduced in order to limit as much as possible any horizontal displacement of this cap. Now, the excavation was made by this earth pressure balance seal. These machines are improving almost every day, and you have now the possibility of controlling many variables, not only in the machine, but also outside, and then have almost in real time any information that you wish about the details of the excavation. But for this particular example, we have the idea of developing a more simplified procedure to analyze the effect of the wall by using also fundamental solutions. But in this case, the problem is a little bit simpler because my wall is a long structure and the tunnel also is a long structure. So you may think that in two dimensions, with the hypothesis of plane strain, you may certainly have capture essentially the fundamentals of this problem. So the idea was again to use a linear elastic isotropic soil under undrained conditions, but now the fundamental solutions are, as I said, a bit simplified because, for instance, in the case of the equivalent to the building case, so loads inside the half space, there was a solution by Melan few years before Milding for a concentrated line load, because this is all that we need in a plane strain problem. And the second one, I call it fundamental. It's not fundamental in the sense of being mathematically correct for an elastic soil, no. It's a solution for the movements around tunnels, which introduces the Sagaseta solution. But they modified it on the basis of some experience in order to approximate a little bit better the deformations that were measured in a number of tunnels. But it is an analytic solution, and this is why I call it fundamental solution. So you can use it in the same manner as other analytic solutions. For this particular development, I should mention the fundamental role of my colleague, Alberto Ledesma, is a professor in our group in Barcelona. And if you are interested, there is a paper giving all the details published in 2017. Now, in order to illustrate the procedure, which is very similar to what I said before, but probably in this case, you will have some additional details. Imagine that you are interested in the vertical displacements and in a calculation, a simple calculation procedure. Now the wall will be just this very simple linear structure here. You can divide it into a number of steps here, right? And then in each one of these points, you will have applied, for instance, a vertical load. Right? And also you have the pile tip load. So this is my structure. And now let's go to the soil. In the soil we have the same and that opposite loads acting on the soil at the same points, but now we will have also the tunnel. The tunnel will induce displacements everywhere. Now, just for you to have an idea of what look like these equations, this is the Melan equation for the vertical displacement at the pile, at the wall axis. It's not the pile, this is a wall, right? In my representation. For instance, to a given force here. And now this gives you the displacement in the vertical direction, in the position of x equals zero, right? So in this particular vertical direction. So these vertical displacements along this z axis due to a force located at any point. Now, using this geometrical interpretation here, just for these are some of the parameters here, This is the expression for this vertical displacement, C. What about the tunnel? Well, the tunnel, I represented here the way in which Ranganathan and Bulos actually considered in a relatively more advanced manner the distribution of the volume loss. And that this expression has some theoretical part, as I said before, but also some modification introducing a more appropriate, let's call it in this manner, ground loss. So this is the vertical displacement you see is directly proportional to this ground loss. And now this ground loss has this expression here. And now this epsilon zero is my VS star, you will remember it, so whatever, 1%. Again, this solution is interesting because there is no any reference here, direct reference to any stiffness of the soil, except for this ground loss. All right, now, how can proceed? Well, as I mentioned before, you have to establish the compatibility, which means making them equal, the vertical displacements of the soil and my structure. And of course, you have to have equilibrium. In the case of the soil displacements, we have two displacements, two sets of displacements, of origin of displacements. Those induced by the tunnel excavation, which corresponds to the Longanathan and Pulos solution, plus the wall soil interface forces, I am in the soil, I apply those forces to the soil using the Melan expression. What about the wall? The wall is very simple to solve, the displacements of the wall. This is just an elastic piece. So, well, you can go through this, so absolutely simple. And then, of course, you have to ensure the equilibrium of your pipe. So this is just a single pipe. Single section of my wall, to be more precise. Now, one interesting characteristic of the analytical solutions, if you combine them, etc., is that your problem can be formulated in terms of dimensionless coefficients. This is a way of generalizing your solution, and certainly you get also a more elegant expression, and it tells you those dimensionless coefficients, what are the actual properties or aspects that control the behavior of your particular problem. Now, in this case, we found that there are three dimensionless coefficients which are typically related to geometry, pi 1, pi 2, pi 3. So d is the distance between my wall and the center of the tunnel in the horizontal sense. And then you have the depth of the center of the tunnel, which is h, and then the length of the pipe. So those lengths define the basic geometry. But in addition to that, there is a stiffness ratio, which is this pi 4 dimensionless coefficient that also controls the behavior of your wall when you excavate your tunnel. And this is the ratio of a generalized stiffness of the soil divided by a generalized stiffness of your wall. This AW means wall, and A means the area of this wall per unit length. Now let me show you the results of solving this problem. Imagine that I define, an invented case. So this is a base case. So it's a pure academic exercise in which I define my geometry in the manner indicated here. So this is the distance of the pipe wall to the center of the tunnel, etc. This is the stiffness ratio. And then I am interested in looking at the effect of the wall length. Now, what I have here is, imagine this is the horizontal surface of the soil. This is my X coordinate, right? And now zero corresponds to the axis of the tunnel. And then imagine that I have a wall which is separated from the axis of the tunnel 2 times the radius. So this is the position of the wall. Of course, this wall is introduced here to protect whatever you have here. For instance, my church. So this is why I say here, this is the protected area. And what you have represented here are the calculated settlement troughs for different wall lengths. Zero, and then I have the green field. Green field means that I don't have any wall, right? It's just my half space. Or my wall length is to radius of 4, 6, 8, etc. So when you increase this number here, of course you have more protection for your church, right? For your structure. Now this problem can be represented by these dimensionless coefficients that I've already mentioned. And there is another one which is fundamental here, which actually enters directly into the Longanathan and Poulos equation, which is the volume loss. So imagine that the volume loss is just 1%. Well, what you can see here is that my nice symmetrical Gauss curve for greenfield conditions is distorted and deformed in order to protect this area here. And you can see that the displacements here become, the vertical displacements, much smaller than the previous cases. So in the previous cases, without any wall, you will go directly towards the greenfield solution. But now, because of your wall, you have smaller and smaller vertical displacements. This is clear. What is the effect of this wall? You may have also, you may be interested in defining just the number to represent what I was explaining. For instance, what is the efficiency? The efficiency in the sense, I mean, how good is this wall to protect my structure? For instance, in terms of the length of this wall. Okay, you can define this efficiency. So you can read it. So this is the displacement for the greenfield conditions minus the displacement in the protected area just behind the wall divided by this reference. Here again, the greenfield. So this is a number that goes from 0 to 1. And then you can represent this number as a function of the length, dimensionless length. And then as your length increases, your efficiency increases and increases more. Now this arrow here indicates a point in which the length of your pipe coincides with the invert of your tunnel. Now, if your piles increase in length, well, you still continue all the time to the efficiency towards, you know, higher numbers here. Now, what about other effects? For instance, the wall stiffness. Well, I can repeat the analysis that I said before, but in this case, you can read everything here. The only thing that I change now is the same type of plot. So now I maintain a given length. So this now my length is 4 times the radius. But now I am changing this stiffness ratio. The stiffness ratio for a given soil is typically controlled by the stiffness of your wall. Now, this is, you know, this number decreases, your stiffness of the wall increases. And you see how you move from your green field towards better protection. Okay, so this is the protected area. Now, if you represent this efficiency number that I've said before as a function of this stiffness ratio, you have this curve here. And you see that when you increase the wall stiffness, you increase relatively fast your efficiency, but beyond some point, you know, beyond some stiffness ratio here, well, there is a very small increase in efficiency. So you may think a good design solution will be to be around this kink point here, this kink here, right? Because probably it becomes the most optimum one in terms even of economy. In order to be a little bit more sure of the value of this analytical solution, if you compare it with a finite element analysis, we were interested in representing the same base case that I mentioned to you by finite elements. I don't give you the details of the finite elements, but I hear you have some hints. There was, you know, a big mass of soil with this it's a big rectangle, 160 meters wide, 100 meters deep, just to avoid the boundary effects. But there was a problem because the volume loss is difficult to define. Of course, you have to go to details of your finite element analysis, but you have to adjust your volume loss with our very simple way of specifying the volume loss. And what we said was that, okay, let's adjust my finite element so that we reproduce the same maximum settlement of my example at the axis, you know, of the tunnel, right, which is right here. And I've represented here on the right, and you have to compare this figure with the previous one for the analytic case. All of the cases represented here corresponds to the finite elements. So this is the protected area here on the right. Okay, it's not exactly the same. You have some differences, but typically you get the same solution. Your wall, my wall, protection wall is right here. But there is here some information which I think is interesting. Now compare two greenfield solutions. This is the greenfield solutions for the elastic case. It's a wide Gauss curve. However, for the Longarazan Ampulos is much narrower. It's narrower. And this is what happens in reality. And this is a nice thing about the Longarazan Ampulos solution, because they actually try to simulate real cases. And there are also theoretical and fundamental reasons for this narrow spread of our settlements in real tunnels, which are typically related with the variation, very, very important variation of stiffness of the soil with shear deformations. All right, so if I compare the analytic solutions with the elastic finite elements as a function of this length of the wall in terms of the efficiency, well, these are the differences between the two. Which one is better? You don't know. You cannot say that the finite elements is better, not at all, because it depends, for instance, on the volume loss, which essentially is difficult to isolate, and my previous comments. And but there was some additional work in a paper published by these two authors, Glot and Russo, in 2013, in which they took the same example and they introduced some improvements into the finite elements, for instance, introducing a soil stiffness increasing with depth. And then these points here, this range here corresponds to their analysis, which is closer to our analytical solution. So just the standard elastic finite elements is not particularly good to explain the displacements, right, induced by the tunnel excavation. Now, let's consider again from a little bit different perspective this problem of my Sagrada Familia church. Now, in this picture here, you have the machines working in the construction of this wall. In fact, the wall, remember, was made of piles. And those piles, they were not tangent even, so there was a gap between those piles. So this collection of piles, in fact, is a pile group. It's a pile group, a very special pile group. In fact, that in the previous solution, we made it similar to a wall. But I could also use my general solution for a pile group and also to see what happened. But let me now consider my work, right? If I can continue with my dimensionless coefficients, those are the pi 1, pi 2, pi 3, and pi 4 for the best approximation of my soil and also the equivalent continuous wall to a set of piles. And those are the numbers that come from this way of approaching a continuous wall to a set of parts. Now, what is the effect of the ratio of the soil and wall stiffness on the efficiency? The Sagrada Familia, which is a real case, is this green line here. This blue line corresponds to my previous academic example, just for you to have a comparison there. What is nice here is that, remember this king here, I was telling you, well, probably locating my design around this area here will be perhaps the most economic or the optimal solution. And this is the position of this stiffness ratio for the Sagrada Familia. So I think that the selection for the pile wall was relatively good, you know, if I look at this particular criterion. Now, what about the pile length and the effect on efficiency? This is the length of the pile is 8 times the radius. The radius is 5 meters around, a little bit more, but it's about that. So 8 times 5 is 40, a little bit more. So for 40 meters long piles, efficiency is around 0.65, which is not a very high efficiency, but this is what could be done there. It's not bad. So this is the efficiency calculated with our particular model. Of course, you never trust in analytical solutions, and you never trust on numerical solutions when you have a very complicated solution problem. And then, of course, all of us, what we do is to measure carefully as much as we can the behavior of the soil and the structures, especially in a case such as this one, which involves such a singular building. Now, this is the instrumentation in the vicinity of the church. The church is here, and here are also some buildings. And then you can read the different types of sensors that we installed here. Of particular interest are just the vertical deformations of many points. Here are those triangles in red in a direction which goes along the street, the Mallorca street, and also perpendicular to it. When you have another street that goes perpendicular to the Mallorca street, etc. So we have quite a bit of information, and also information about the behavior of the structure itself, for the Sagrada Familia, using many targets, etc., to measure displacements in any direction. Let me show you some results. Now, this is a cross section of the Mallorca street, so this is perpendicular to the Mallorca street, and this is typically what you have when we plot these Gaussian settlement troughs. This is my Gaussian settlement troughs in a street perpendicular to the front street, the Mallorca street. Now, this is the wall. This is the protection wall. These are the piles of the church. This is the church here. And those are the displacement. The protected area is here, right? Now, look at the scale here, the settlement on the left. This is the zero value. Now, there are two curves here. They are almost the same. One corresponds to immediately after the passage of the shield, and the other one is the, well, just some measurement that was made some time later. So there was almost no change, a little bit more settlement than not too much. And you see that in the protected area, the displacements, the vertical displacements were essentially zero. But you see the effect of the wall, because you have some displacements here on the street, and reach a maximum at the wall, but on the left side, but this maximum is, well, no more than a couple of millimeters. Now, the continuous lines here in black corresponds to finite element analysis. The real continuous one corresponds to an analysis of the finite elements with no loads from any monuments or buildings around. And the second case, D, corresponds to the same analysis in which we introduce the loads of all the buildings affected. This tried to be the best our best representation in terms of finite elements of this case, but we have to introduce, in order to approximate this case, some expected volume loss. And this is a decision that you have to make before, of course, you make the construction. So at the stage of designing everything, right? Now, for this 0.5%, this is what you get. For instance, the maximum settlement predicted at the center of the street was something like 7 millimeters or so against one or even less measure. And also the same, you know, disagreement between the calculations and the actual displacements. Certainly, the 0.5% was not the actual volume loss for this particular excavation. Those are the measured vertical displacements along the street. Now here you have now your structure, the church, and again, the two lines are essentially the same at two particular times after the passage of the shield. Now predicted in the project with a volume loss of 0.5%, as I mentioned before, something like 7-8 millimeters is this blue line here. against the real one, which is 1-2 millimeters at most. This is an extremely successful construction of a large tunnel in the center of the city. Now, I have another possibility of examining the behavior of this wall is just realizing that, well, it was not exactly a wall in the sense of this two-dimensional analysis, but as I also mentioned before, my wall is in fact a group. It's a linear group of piles, but it is a group. So if I consider just an arbitrary point here, an arbitrary pile, for instance, this P7 here, I may just discretize a long line of piles, my tunnel, and I could also actually represent the construction of the tunnel, and then concentrate my attention on this pile 7, which is just any pile. For instance, those are the horizontal y displacements and bending moments predicted by our numerical analysis. And well, you already are familiar with this type of curves. This is the horizontal displacements in the y direction. You remember that you get a maximum which is more or less located at the position of the center of the tunnel. And those are the associated moments, which is again the curvature of these displacement curves, etc. So we have all kind of information now. For instance, those are the vertical displacements and the axial forces. What about the vertical displacements? Well, from our best approximation for that particular soil, etc., very small, very difficult to measure. So just for the, remember the time step 100, so when the tunnel is far away from the Sagrada Familia position, then well, the maximum is around 0.3 millimeters or so, 0.35 at the top. And with this compression, actually, and you remember also the reason for this compression, it's because those displacements in the vertical direction go in opposite sense, etc., with these axial forces, which are not particularly high, of course, for those big piles. Now, what is our best approximation using our analytical approach? Well, the best approximation is for a volume loss, which is, well, quite small, and even smaller than this one, 0.1%, you reach this particular description or curve, which is the theoretical curve. And in the protected area, essentially, you have zero displacements. All right, so I'm coming to the end now. Again, you never trust in just one way of calculating or one procedure. And you, of course, look at many possibilities, you know, of controlling the risk. And how can we limit, especially in complicated soils, for instance, in soft soils, the volume loss associated with a shield tunneling? And we have a nice possibility, which is controlling the pressures that this machine is capable of introducing in the soil in order to control or to avoid or to reduce the volume loss. We have P1, which is the pressure of our machine in the front. We also have the possibility of injecting through the shield itself, for instance, mixture of typically bentonite and cement. And also we may inject using grout, a cement grout, this gap, the one which is here, P3, which is at the tail of our shield, is the one that actually produces the most important part of the displacements, of the vertical displacements. So P3 is perhaps the one of, together with P1, the best procedure that we have available in order to control vertical displacements in this type of machines. In fact, we have direct information coming from the field, coming from this particular case, from the construction of the line 9 of the Barcelona underground. It's a very long line. It has around 40 kilometers in length. And these are just plots of the change in the volume loss calculated by measuring displacements in cross sections, you know, to the construction of the tunnel, and then just integrating the, your displacement curve, and then you get some volume loss. And you see that there is a correlation between the increase in the face pressure, for instance, and the decrease of the volume loss. And also the grouting pressure P3, which is at the tail of our machine, also is a clear correlation between the volume loss and the grouting pressure. Now you may think, well, this is now the best solution, but yeah, but there are limits for that. I mean, you cannot increase and increase more and more the face pressure because you enter into another difficulties. The machines are designed for a given state of stress inside, and you may have difficulties in running your machine with increase very much with face pressure. And also you may have some blow up conditions, so you can actually displace the soil in the opposite direction. Even you can fail the soil in compression. And so there are limits for those pressures in practice. But nevertheless, this is a good solution. Now, in order also to perform and to achieve a nice construction, you have to control your machine. It has to be always in good conditions, which means, for instance, that your cutting wheel should be well equipped with the cutting tools, etc. And you have to replace them, they can be broken, they can be wear, etc. And you do that by inspecting directly in under atmospheric conditions your ship. And what can you do? What can you do? Well, you can take your machine through a shaft, as indicated here. So this is just a big well, okay, this is a shaft, for instance, 40 meters deep or more, and then you can go down. And then you can look at the machine, replace whatever you need, etc. This is what was done in this particular project. These are just some pictures of these operations. This is the construction of this particular shaft in an area in which you don't have much space. Here is this church, and this is a nice machine, which is kind of a tunnel boring machine that actually goes in the vertical direction. So it is operating there. You don't see here you see the towers of this vertical shaft. And also you may have also some glimpse of our soils in Barcelona. This is our red unsaturated old quaternary soil. The one that I said is stiff as unsaturated. And so as excavated by this piling machine, and here you have all the piles, and here is the church. It's very, very close. And you can see up here also the street, the Mallorca street, which is relatively narrow. Yeah, right? You don't, of course, you don't like these things, but cities are what they are. All right, so I come to the end. These are the lessons learned. And I would say that integrating fundamental solutions into these problems of interaction, I think leads to simple and fast calculation tools. And I also would like to say that they are powerful because they provide us with such an insight into the behavior of the tunnel and the structure, which is difficult to gain just by, it's much more difficult, you know, by looking at the just standard solutions or numerical analysis. So, as I said here, they provide a good insight into the mechanics of the problem and the mechanisms which are behind the behavior that we observe. But something that also probably you already realize is that three-dimensional geometries are not a particular problem. In fact, those solutions, the ones that I mentioned, some of them are very general three-dimensional solutions. And of course, you have to compare the ease offered by these solutions with the difficulty of three-dimensional analysis using, for instance, finite elements. And then those solutions help designing, and I've shown you some examples, at a very reduced cost. Now remember also that formulations are possible, especially if you have linear relationships between the different aspects or the mechanics of your problem. And they are especially useful because of the generality and the possibility of conducting sensitivity analysis at a zero cost, essentially. And also, I should say that complex finite element solutions, very often they provide illusory accuracy, and then the problem is that the volume loss is determining the behavior of the tunnel and the soil around the tunnel. And this volume loss depends on things that are difficult to discretize, are difficult actually to characterize in numbers. For instance, the machine performance of the workmanship of the people working in the machine. And finally, I didn't have time in this presentation to talk about compensation grouting, so this is a way of counteracting the vertical displacements, the settlements, just by injecting in some particular location around your tunnel a volume, a grout, for instance, and then you may reduce your settlements. Well, the compensation grouting is can be easily handled because, well, the solutions are general. So my volume loss can be just by changing the sign, a volume increase. And then essentially the same problem can be solved by the same system of equations that are changing the sign. And in particular, we can solve in a unified manner the question of the tunneling and in real time and at the same time, the injection of the compensation grouting and of course the behavior of our pile group, for instance. Now, come now to the acknowledgements. I would like to thank a number of people associated with consulting firms, as Davor Simic, Sergio Sanchez, Leoncio Prieto, from different consulting firms or construction firms also, Eero Espina from also from the consult, and in particular to the Spanish Railway Administration, ADIF, because of the many years of very successful, I think, and very interesting cooperation with them in many different projects. And then to my colleagues, most of them from UPC, Alberto Ledesma, I mentioned him, Dr. Ana Ramón, Linier Mayoral, he was the author of the of one of the analysis programs that I mentioned to you, Simon Sauter, he was also a master's student from Zurich, Alessandra Di Mariano, and Mercedes Sondón for their help in this presentation. And finally, my thanks to you for your attention.